go right back to the beginning and look at kind of your early musical memories, I wonder sort of how much do you remember of being a little kid and sitting at the piano, messing around and doing those early compositions?
Well, the vivid memory that I often tell people about is of drifting off to sleep and hearing my mother playing the piano in the distance. She was an architect by day, but at night when the kids were asleep, she would play the piano and then I would wake up and try and copy what she was playing. But that quickly, which was bits of Debussy, Deux Arabesques, I remember, Clair de Lune, Handel's Largo, bits of Oklahoma. It was quite a Catholic range of music. And she was a churchgoer, so my mother was Catholic and we were brought up Catholic. And so quite early on, the organ features as an experience, as a sound. And I can remember playing the piano and trying to make it sound like an organ, just by sheer force. By playing it as loudly as I could. And so there was always a mixture of hearing pieces that were awe-inspiring. I was given a wonderful LP of Bach organ music, and again, trying to play some of that on the piano. But that would always drift into making up stuff, which eventually I realized was easier than learning other people's music. I could just make up my own and I didn't need to practice at all.
Do you still have any of those really early pieces?
Oh, practically nothing was written down. So it was all, when I say making up, I mean, it was really just in the moment. So it was really improvising. And improvising always came easily, and composition actually came quite hard. So the journey to being able to write down music that felt like me, or that was the music I wanted to hear, was very long. As a composer of finished pieces that are written down, I was a very late starter. So there was always music going on throughout my childhood, and that included singing in the church choir from quite little, and I was about 9, I think. And then when I was 12, I was playing the organ in the church services. Although I would still say that probably the piano was my greater passion. But I played violin, which became viola. So there was orchestral music and choral music, sacred and secular. The thing that there wasn't really was opera, which that came in my 20s. So lots of playing, lots of listening, and lots of making stuff up at the piano. And then it was really, I think the first pieces I can remember really writing down were for me to play with a couple of friends. But I was already a teenager by then. And they weren't very good. They weren't pieces that, I hope I haven't kept them. I wouldn't want anyone trying to play them now. But I had two friends, the three of us all played the violin, played the piano, played the organ, and we all had perfect pitch. And so we really liked to improvise together. And it was to sort of celebrate that I remember writing something. And I remember writing a mass for the church where I was playing the organ, which was in English, and it was kind of jolly, I think. It was a jolly mass with a Gloria in 12:8.
Excellent.
Very festive feeling. But it was never, I was never really satisfied with the music that I could write. I was probably more satisfied with the music that I could play, and the improvising would be sometimes, I mean, mainly improvising was for myself in private, but it was sometimes in public. I realized that it could take me months to get a Bach, toccata and fugue really good at the organ, particularly with the pedal part. But I could make up something on the spot that would sound exciting or do whatever it was supposed to do at the end of a service, or, while waiting for the bride to arrive. And so why go to the pain and headache of learning difficult pieces? So I did quite a lot of improvising of that kind. I can't now remember really what it sounded like. It was, my mind, to my ear at the time, it was exciting and thrilling. And you know, the organ is a very exciting instrument.
And do you think that your compositional process now sort of actually follows quite a similar process to what you're doing then, i.e. sitting, working something out at the piano, playing around with ideas before it actually gets onto paper?
It very often, yes. It very rarely arrives sort of through the ether. Do you know? I mean, sometimes there have been times when I've found the right words for, let's say, for a choral piece, and finding the right words is usually the hardest thing for any vocal piece. And usually takes longer than writing the music. But writing, finding the right words is also about finding, you know, that's telling you what kind of sound you're going to make. So once you've got the right words, you've already done quite a lot of composing, you know, the mood, the shape of the piece and so on. Now I'm rambling and I've slightly lost the thread of the question. Ask the question again.
It's okay. I was just saying, when you're actually writing a piece, is it mostly kind of messing around at the piano, in inverted commas, before the actual process of writing down? Because I know that
I was going to contrast. On the one hand, occasionally I've had this lovely experience of assembling some texts that I think these are exactly the words I want to sing, and just sitting quietly and imagining the music and it all kind of arriving. And so that felt like, well, I'm just transcribing it. You know, the music's already there in the air and I'm just going to write it down. But more often there's quite a lot of exploration and a lot of sketching, finding, usually I begin with the accompaniment, and it's finding that where there's a, you know, I suppose about half of the choral pieces I've written have an organ accompaniment, but the others are a cappella. Finding the right kind of harmony, the right territory, the right key, the right mode. That's the sort of background choice. And it's trial and error for me usually. But I may think, oh, yes, this is probably going to be in B-flat minor. I might think that. But then when I start exploring ideas, something else comes along that demands to be written. And it's only really once that sort of preliminary feeling about the piece is clear that the melodies start to connect with the words or come out of the words.
About your time at Cambridge, so fast forwarding a little bit, if it was anything like it is now, I imagine it must have been incredibly intense. What did your sort of musical life look like when you were there?
It was quite action-packed. I remember that in my first term, which is after all, it was only 8 weeks, and I remember playing in 18 concerts, which that was a combination of some orchestral playing, some accompanying, some solo piano performances and some chamber music. I was thrilled to be playing the Brahms piano quintet, which is a piece I'd always loved, and finally here with the you know, most wonderful string players. So there was continual performance. I mean, crazily, because there are all these extraordinary choirs in Cambridge, and I never heard any of them while I was there. I just didn't get up in time to do, you know. Well, actually, were there even morning services? There probably were, but I would have missed them. That was that seems crazy now, but you know, I was following other interests and discovering lots of music and exploring ideas about music with friends and staying up far too late with too much coffee.
But I think that's one of the brilliant things about Cambridge in a way, is that you can have your best musical moments or academic moments through those late night alcohol-fueled conversations. I remember a friend of mine actually did a Sunday evening organ recital, which was Rite of Spring for organ duets, which they kind of just dreamt up of an evening, and it turned into this amazing concert. I think I love the fact that you can take those risks. So did you, as a composer, did you find that it was an opportunity to kind of explore new ideas?
I wasn't there yet. Do you know, I was still at the improvising stage, really. And I mean, God knows really what my neighbours must have made of it, on people on the same staircase. Listening to someone really thinking aloud at the piano hour after hour. But my finished compositions, there weren't so many. You know, I studied in my last year, I studied with Robin Holloway, and I should have turned up every week with a new piece of music. And quite often, I don't know, I guess I was in a bit of a dream, and I might turn up with not having written anything at all, and we would play, I don't know, Mahler Symphony on two pianos instead, which was very educational. Or, I mean, Robin was fantastic at seeing the possibilities in ideas that were latent in ideas that I had. So little scraps or beginnings of pieces that I would show him and say, well, if you want to write this kind of piece, or if this is your starting idea, then you could think about this, and suggesting ways forward. And over time, those kinds of ideas must have gradually, you know, worked upon me. But I really, by the time I left Cambridge, I had written, you know, a few pieces for my degree. I hadn't foolishly taken advantage of the huge number of instrumentalists and singers that there are at hand, that you could have for nothing. And, you know, if I'd been more advanced, I could have made use of that that time, those opportunities. But I left with very little written, and still I wouldn't say that I had found my own musical voice. I discovered some things that I couldn't do. So I had attempted to write serial music. I remember my first composition lesson with Robin Holloway, I took along a 20-page serial organ piece. And I started to play it through to him. And on page two, he said, I'm bored already. And I thought, he's right. This isn't the most exciting thing I can think of. And if I'm not writing the most exciting thing I can think of, why not? And when am I going to? And trying to find out how to write the most exciting thing I could think of was going to take another 10 years. During which time I wrote pieces, and I wrote for particularly a singer friend. But it was only when I started writing for dance, that I was able to really write what I wanted, because it dawned on me that no one was going to be really listening to the music. You know, people had come to watch people dancing, and, you know, they would be aware of the music, but that wasn't the primary focus. And that gave me license to write whatever I wanted. And as soon as I thought that, I imagined, I could hear this little, it was a pizzicato bass pattern. It was a 17 quaver figure that it was clearly going to repeat and repeat, and melodies were going to flow over the top. And I immediately thought, yeah, this is exactly what I want to hear. And this is never going to be promoted by the Society for the Promotion of New Music. This is not respectable new music, and it's not what we're supposed to be doing. But I thought, well, I think there's enough respectable new music going on. I'm going to do this instead. And I went on and wrote a dozen pieces for a particular dance duo, which was an amazing chance to just to explore sounds that I really wanted to make without worrying about what the critics might say, because no one was going to be reviewing these pieces for their musical content. So I needed to be out of the spotlight, I think, to finally sort out for myself the sounds I really wanted to make, and how they behave, how to shape music of that kind.
I read a quote from you that I really enjoyed where you talked about how you sort of realised that some music was amazing to play, but boring to an audience, I guess in the same way as perhaps the piece you're talking about for the organ. And I think actually, particularly with the organ, that can so often be the case. You can, I mean, it's the Front Matin Passacaglia, for example, I love performing, but it's because you're inside the piece and you can feel every little bit of harmony. And actually a lot of people who come to listen to that, if they're not an organist, say, oh, I'm not sure, it goes on a little bit. So how did you kind of make that, how did you have the realization of what people liked to hear as opposed to what you like to play?
Well, you're absolutely right. That did happen. And people will just tell you, this goes on a bit, it's too long. I think probably the most useful thing was finding ways of standing back from the piece. And obviously one way is when it's performed, but it's better to solve the problems before it, the first performance, if you can. And actually just having a tape recorder, I realized, made all the difference, just to record the piece and then listen to it as if I hadn't written it, as if it were by somebody else, and just wait and see, well, am I engaged by this or not? And quite often it would turn out, oh, I see, yes. I was really enjoying, particularly because, I mean, so much was at the piano to begin with. And there's a sort of, I don't know, kinetic excitement about just about playing. But when I listen back in the cold light of day, I think, oh gosh, yes, this, absolutely, as everyone is saying, this is going on a bit. Mm. You know, it was a good idea. It's not that the ideas weren't, had no value or merit, but the feeling, I suppose the sense of time is just different when you're making the sounds happen. And then something else is going on, which is, the physical engagement and then the challenge of trying to play so many notes at once or at a certain speed. So you could say that there was a sort of, the physical component of the music perhaps was more fun than the purely audible component.
And with your opera writing, how much of that do you think is kind of the result of all your time spent as a repetiteur? Because I imagine, particularly with your process of working at the piano a lot, that must be the dream, to be able to have the repetiteur skills of reducing something down and still hearing everything, all the detail.
Yeah. Well, it was most of 10 years in which I was doing all kinds of piano playing, but being a repetiteur was the lion's share of that, probably. And so there was an amazing apprenticeship in opera composing and what happens in operas. And as a repetitor, you're trying to make the piano sound like an orchestra, and having the orchestral colours in your mind makes a difference to the way you play. But you're also in this brilliant position to find out how singers work and to get a real understanding of how much they're doing that isn't just singing. So they're learning 2 hours of music by memory, and very few musicians perform that amount of music from memory. But they're inhabiting a character, they're in a story, and they're working their way through a physical production, which has all kinds of challenges. And that certainly gave me a sense that if I wanted my operas to really live, there needed to be room for the singers to do their acting, and that so the music shouldn't be so complex and so, let's say, unpredictable, that the singer would be forced to spend the whole time staring, hopefully, at the conductor, desperately waiting for you and trying to keep track of all of the changing time signatures. There's an element of entrusting that, trusting that the performer is going to bring a lot to the performance. So I don't need to do absolutely everything. Mm. I'm taking the piece a certain part of the way, and then they're completing it. I mean, that's true of every piece, of course, that the performer completes the piece. Well, the performer and the audience together complete the piece. So the score is a sort of starting point. And every performer or group of performers actually makes a different kind of journey from that from that starting point.
And I guess actually, particularly when you're writing for choral forces, there is so much variation in terms of the group that could end up singing it. So you could have children on the top, you could have adults on the top, you could have professional lay clerks, you could have students, as in the case of our choir. Do you think that you sort of write a piece with that in mind? So if you're commissioned by a group with children, you write it slightly differently to if it was an adult group?
Yeah, yes. I mean, I think one always writes for the, I certainly write for the first performance. So whoever's playing it, I wanted to make sure it works for them. In fact, if I write the piece well, probably quite different groups will end up performing it. So having thought a lot about what words would make sense sung by a large group of people when I wrote a piece called The Passing of the Year, which is for the London Symphony Chorus. So thinking, what can 150 people say together, sing together? It was amazing then to hear, a number of choirs, but particularly Voces 8 most recently, singing it with one voice to a part. So eight singers doing what was 150. And the piece speaks actually quite in a quite different way, and certain things work particularly well with just solo voices, it turns out. So you imagine the piece for the premiere, and then if it has, you know, a life in it, that will be manifest in lots of different ways. There are things, and I haven't always done this right, but I remember writing for the Eton choral course, a piece that Ralph Allward asked for. And I think I had been used, probably the first piece I'd written for choir, first anthem I'd written was, the first anthem was Seek Him That Maketh the Seven Stars and Orion, which was for St. James's Piccadilly, where I knew that there were going to be eight singers, and it was a mixed choir. So there was no question of what can boy trebles do. I'm not sure now, you know, I cannot tell you now whether they had male altos or mezzo sopranos singing the alto line. I don't remember thinking about the range of them, because I remember then went later writing this piece for Ralph Allward that he said, but you've written above D for the altos. And I hadn't thought, oh, that would be difficult for countertenors. And of course I've written for countertenors who can sing quite a lot higher than D, because of course all vocal ranges are unique. And in a solo context, there are all kinds of things you can do, but in a choral context, it makes sense to respect what the normal boundary is. And so I had to kind of rethink that. So just very specifically the range, understanding the ranges of different kinds of choirs and different makes up of choirs is certainly important for making sure that the first performance can happen. I think that the piece I mentioned in Seek Him That Maketh the Seven Stars and Orion, I knew that the choir was going to essentially learn the piece on the day of the performance, that they would arrive half an hour before the service, that they would sing through it. So it had to be readable. It couldn't be, you know, that sets a certain limit on complexity. But I was told that the organ part could be as hard as I wanted because it would be practiced beforehand. And that seemed to work. And so I think that, to some extent, has been an unconscious template. I mean, I told you I played the organ in my local church, but it was a Catholic church, so it was just the hymns, occasionally a sung mass, but really not that often. And the Church of England has got all kinds of other requirements, musical requirements, for various different kinds of worship. And I'm still a little bit hazy about some of them. So there's a learning experience every time I write for choir.
Seek Him is actually the first piece of yours that we did with Pembroke. And I think firstly, the organist loved playing it because it was a chance for him to kind of have a bit of fun. But also, all of the choral lines are just so eminently singable. And it sounds sort of, it almost sounds more complex than it is. And I think that's a really genius thing, to write something that a choir can just sort of jump straight into and love singing.
I also want the audiences to understand, to hear and feel the words. And that's harder with a choral piece. And you may not hear every single word in a choral piece because you're performing in a reverberant acoustic. And when you have several people singing the same words, singing the same part, it's never going to be absolutely as comprehensible as one solo voice. So somebody singing a song on the piano, you're probably going to hear more of the words than you might hear an anthem in a chapel or a cathedral with a bit of echo. But still, that wanting the audience to have that experience and that feeling, ideally the first time. I don't want them, because you never know if people are going to hear a piece a second time. And I have been drawn to powerful poetry, and I think that is another thing that people in our audience have certainly have told me that they respond to a lot, that the words themselves are already worth hearing, and then there's music as well. So it's a good start to begin with with good poems.
Well, that actually leads really nicely onto Into Thy Hands, which is the piece that we've just recorded with the choir. Firstly, because of the text, but secondly, I mean, you mentioned the importance of space and acoustics. And I believe that was written for the Abbey in Pontigny, which has this huge acoustic. How did you draw that into the writing?
You're exactly right. I was told that it was the Salisbury Cathedral Choir, and their patron is St. Edmund, and his tomb is in Pontigny. And I was told that there was a 7-second echo there. And I thought, well, there's one aspect of my idiom that it's not problematic, which is that I'm writing, I think of it as modal music, but I suppose most people will perceive it as tonal. But I suppose the important thing is that the harmony is not continually shifting. So, because it can be very hard to follow 19th century music in a very boomy acoustic, with late 19th century music, where the harmony is moving quite rapidly. Well, I like to be in a single mode or a single scale for as long as possible. So if there's some blending of sound, that's not disturbing. But I thought more than that, I also needed to allow some breath. So I wrote in quite a lot in the bars of silence, but in which you would simply hear, the chords dying away. In fact, I don't know how I was not able to join the choir for the premiere, so I've not actually heard it in such a reverberant space. And I have heard the piece sung in a concert hall with practically no reverberation at all, and it still makes sense because there's an element of reflection involved. So it gives you a chance to think about what's just been sung for a moment before the next phrase. But it was a particular thing that was one thing that I thought of for that unusual first performance venue.
Well, we were quite lucky in that we were recording in a church near Cambridge, which has, it's St George's Chesterton. I'm not sure if you've come across it, but it's got a lovely, huge acoustic. And the choir are used to singing in Pembroke Chapel, which has quite a small acoustic. And the first time we went in there, in fact, yours was the first piece we recorded. And the look on their faces when they sang those first couple of bars and then just heard it kind of carrying on. And they were like, oh, this is what it's supposed to sound like. It was lovely, actually. It's really nice. thing I'd really like to talk about is the work that you've done with children and getting children into opera, specifically thinking about the Hackney Chronicles and On Spitalfields and the process of actually involving children in the composition. How did that come about?
Involving the performers in the composition of operas is something I've done for quite a long time. I think when it's kind of related to do with when I very first started in the world of opera, and I was a repetiteur and assistant chorus master at Glyndebourne. And actually, no, even before that, I think, but it was certainly in that sort of repetiteur period, I got involved in doing outreach projects for various opera companies. And people were looking at ways of introducing repertoire works to school audiences, for example. And I can remember working with a group of children on a project based on the Love for Three Oranges, where they were going to come and see Prokofiev's opera. But as a preparation for that, we made up our own opera in a week. So making up songs together came quite early on as an activity. And it's very enjoyable. And I discovered that this is something you can do with people of all ages. And I have carried on doing it at different times with performers performers who are going to be in an opera. And it usually starts with improvisation. So rather like as my own composing process does. And it's very enjoyable. It can be very enjoyable getting a group of young people improvising together. People don't necessarily think that they like singing, but you can sometimes coax or trick a group of people into singing, and they will discover that they do enjoy it. I've done it in various ways, but quite often after from starting with, you know, some breathing exercises and singing some sort of rather random clusters, or perhaps doing sort of vocalizing over a simple drone, just getting to the point of being happy to think aloud in song, that I might then ask, you know, the group to divide into small groups of twos or threes, and they might each group might have one line of a lyric. And I might ask them to find four or five different ways they could sing that one line. And then we'd all gather around the piano and choose, well, this one goes well with this one, or, this one's got this really interesting rhythm in it, and that could suggest an accompaniment that could be like this. In that case, let's use this one and this one. We weave together. So everyone has explored some of the possibilities of the words and found how the words want to be sung. And then as a sort of collective act of shaping. But in a workshop, you may not get it completely right first time. And with time, I've given myself the license to improve or refine or edit what's come out of the workshop. But people will still recognize their own material. And of course, that's very satisfying for the performers. So I enjoy the feeling of ownership that comes with making up, being part of the composition process. But it also was very informative for me. I think it made a lot of difference. I did this in three large-scale community operas for Glyndebourne, a community opera that I did in London. You mentioned On Spitalfields, which is a community cantata for the Spitalfields Festival. And again, I used the same process there. I've written other works for children, and of course, the Hackney Chronicles, which was just for children. It was an opera for nine-year-olds to perform. And we didn't write the whole piece together, and you know, there's a limit to what you can achieve if you've never written an opera before or composed a note, then you know it's unrealistic to expect a group to be able to make up the whole piece, but everyone can contribute, and it's a satisfying challenge, I think, for me to find ways of weaving together melodies that have come out of a group process. So that they're kind of like found material. It's like, oh, let's use these folk songs, yeah. Or or maybe Michael Tibbet saying, I'm going to use these Negro spirituals in my, you know, Child of Our Time. So you've got something that already exists, but you want to incorporate it into a whole that feels satisfying and organic. And that's, you know, that's just an interesting thing to do as a composer. But it also informs my sense of what a group of young people, what a group of children might find engaging, or what they can remember, what kind of rhythms they naturally respond to or think of. Of course, it would be possible to write things that are very unlike anything they would imagine, and they could probably still learn it. But I found it helpful to have this feeling that there was something that we were sharing, that it's that it was a sort of communal music.
We actually did a very similar thing at Pembroke this year. So we have a girls' choir of girls aged 11 to 18, and we had a writing weekend working on a new disc of Christmas music. So they were writing their own arrangements of Christmas carols. And one of the things we did was actually took a text and said, right, we're going to start from scratch and write an original carol. And the thing that I found most fascinating about it was how actually they all responded in quite similar ways to the text. So they agreed instantly what time signature it should be, what key signature it should be, which really surprised me, and a kind of rough shape of the melody. And I just found it so interesting that a group of very disparate children of a real range of ages could say, oh yeah, no, this text definitely necessitates this response.
Yes. Well, music is a collective thing, and often embodies a group feeling, and also words can have a very strong, they make strong demands. I mean, I think obviously one composer will set a particular poem in a completely different way to another, so we respond to those demands in different ways. But yes, it's interesting working with children and saying, well, what should the accompaniment sound like? And you know, they might say it should sound like chandeliers falling, or this should be like icicles. They might say, oh, it's deep and dark, and then you can try something on the piano and say, well, you mean like this? And they say, well, no, it should be higher, or it should be faster, or something. And everyone else will agree, you're right, that there will be a group feeling of, yes, that's it, you've nailed it, that's the right sound.
We did have a very intense argument about whether or not to have a T.S. Piketty at the end of the piece. It lasted about 20 minutes.
And what was the outcome?
We did have it in the end. The older girls all wanted it and the younger ones didn't, interestingly. Not sure.
Uh-huh.
I realise I've kept you for far too long, but I do have one more question for you, and it's a bit of a rogue one. But I read that your guilty pleasure listening is The Little Mermaid. And I just wondered if you could tell me more about that.
Yes, very guilty indeed. I can't believe I ever admitted that in public. But no, I was completely captivated by that movie. I mean, I've seen other of those Walt Disney, essentially they're musicals, aren't they? And I've also found it's something I've thought about sometimes in relation to writing, well, sometimes operas, but for audiences who may never have heard anything like opera or may not know that they've heard opera. And I'm thinking, but actually lots of people respond to The Little Mermaid and, you know, or Beauty and the Beast or The Lion King. But so the idea of singing a story is not strange to us. But there are certain voices that people get used to, I think, in those musicals. There's a certain, you know, the words are extremely clear in those. But I particularly love it in the Little Mermaid because I think it's a wonderful range of contrasting. So, you know, there's a real different character for each song. So it's not the film I've watched absolutely the most, which is possibly, I'm not sure if it's Cabaret or All About Eve, but it's up there.
Well, I look forward to the Jonathan Dove Disney movie. I'm sure it'll be a fabulous soundtrack.
See?